Hello, my name is Jaap Hagen, and I'll give you a lecture about concepts. The lecture consists of two parts. In this part, the first part, I will address the question what the use of concepts is and what precisely the nature of a concept is. In the second part, I will pay attention to a few very specific legal concepts, such as what ought to be done or what is a competence. But first, what is a concept and why are they useful? So, why are concepts important? Well, suppose, go back in the past, if you had a bad experience with a dangerous animal. It is useful to know that similar animals may also be dangerous. So, take a tiger. You have encountered the tiger, it bit off one of your legs, terrible story, of course. But if you know this, you know also know that you have to be careful about other tigers. But, okay, why other tigers? Tiger is a concept, and it distinguishes between tigers and other animals, or even other things. So having this concept of a tiger makes it possible for you to reason by analogy. This tiger was dangerous, therefore similar animals, also tigers, will also be dangerous. Having a concept for a particular class of animals makes it easier to treat similar animals in similar ways. In the case of tigers, stay away from them. But you can also apply the same line of thought to scientific laws. If you have a scientific law, for instance, heavy things drop to the earth, this admittedly is a very simplistic scientific law, but okay, let's take this to be a scientific law. They deal with kinds of situations, they deal with heavy objects in general. A heavy object is a kind of concept, and if you have a heavy object, you can expect that it will drop to the ground. It happens once. But in the future, most likely, it will happen again. And you can develop a scientific law, but the scientific law does not deal with individual cases. It deals with classes of cases. And the classes are grouped together by means of concepts. So Newton, at least that's what the story is, was awoken by an apple which fell off a tree on his head. And then he developed the theory of gravity, namely that things, that heavy things fall down. Well, actually, the law is much more complicated, but this is a nice story. So that is scientific laws in physics. But the same story also applies to rules. Legal rules, for instance, the rule that it's forbidden to kill other persons, deal with types of agents. This particular rule deals with all agents. All human beings are not allowed to kill other persons. But if you have the rule that car drivers must stop for red traffic lights, the rule deals with a class of person, namely car drivers, and the class is designated by the concepts, the concept of car driver. So rules use concepts to make clear to which persons they apply. And there's still another use. In law, we systematize our knowledge, and not only in law, also in other sciences, but the structure of law is determined by concepts such as crime or obligation or power. So you have criminal law, the law of obligations, and a more general doctrine about having a power, which is important in constitutional law, but also in private law. So those concepts structure the domain. And it makes it easier, for instance, to study the law. Okay, now we have a course, for instance, on law of obligations, or contract law, or property law, or criminal law, or whatever. So concepts are also important for systematizing knowledge. Okay, now we perhaps know why concepts are useful, But it still leaves open the question, what precisely is a concept? Well, in this lecture, I will discuss two theories, what you might call the classical or the philosophical theory, and at the end, very briefly, psychological theory. That one is done very briefly, but because it's to be expected that there will be other lectures on the psychological approaches to concepts. So most attention will go to the classical philosophical theory. And this theory distinguishes between predicates, that's words in language, concepts, and classes. Suppose you have the word tiger. That's an element of a language, in this case, the English language. This word means, and then we again have to use the same word because I don't have to anything else to express myself in, it means tiger. That's a concept. And a concept is a mental entity. At least let's assume that. Plato would disagree, but most people think that concepts are mental entities. So we have a word in a language which stands for, or actually means, more precisely, a concept, and the word the word tiger means tiger as a concept. And then this concept determines in the world which entities precisely are tigers. So you have a concept of tiger, and you have things in the world, and the concept contains criteria, and everything that fits those criteria is a tiger. So the concept determines what a tiger is. Strictly speaking, you cannot have tigers which do not fit the concept, because then they would not have been tigers at all. So the predicate means a concept, and the concept determines a class. And in that way, indirectly, the predicate determines the class, because the predicate goes to the concept and the concept goes to the class. And of course, you can make a shortcut and say that the predicate stands for, or the technical word is, denotes a class. The word tiger denotes tigers as animals. And the concept is in between and includes a set of criteria to determine what precisely tigers are. Now, concepts can be more or less abstract. A very abstract concept is the concept of an animal. And if you make it more precise, you can say, well, you have different kinds of animals, but some animals are animals of prey. They feed on other animals. And the subclass of the animals of prey are tigers. So you have a very abstract concept, the concept of animal, a somewhat more concrete concept, the concept of an animal of prey, and then somewhat lower in the hierarchy, more concrete, is the concept of a tiger. And of course, you can best to make still more concept, concrete concepts, such as Bengalian tigers or female tigers or whatever. You can go along this hierarchy of concepts from very abstract to very concrete. Corresponding to those abstract and concrete concepts are bigger and smaller classes. And the idea is, the more abstract the concept, the bigger the class. So corresponding to the concept of animal is a very big class of animals. A subclass is animals of prey. That's a smaller class. And if a concept is a more concrete variation on a more abstract concept, the class corresponding to the intermediate concept matches the intermediate concept. So you have a smaller class of animals of prey, which is a subclass of animals. And then you have a still smaller class of tigers, which corresponds to the more concrete concept of tiger. So the classes and the relations nicely fit the concepts and the relations. Abstract concepts are bigger classes, more concrete concepts are smaller classes, and if a particular concept is a more concrete variation on a more abstract concept, it stands for a subclass. So the subclass of tigers fits in the bigger class of animals of prey, which in turn fits in the bigger class of animals. So there is a nice correspondence between abstract and concrete concepts and bigger and smaller classes. Another interesting phenomenon in connection to concepts is synonymy and ambiguity. This has to do with relation between words, predicates, and concepts. Take, for instance, the word bank. This is one single word, but it stands for different classes, actually for three, but I only mentioned two of them, and they also stand more for different concepts. So the word bank stands for the concept financial institution, the bank where you can get money or put away money, and the concept piece of furniture to sit on with more than one person. This is called ambiguity. Ambiguity is when one single word, a linguistic entity, means two different concepts or even more concepts. You can also have banks of a river. So in this case, there are at least three concepts corresponding to the word. Such a word is called ambiguous. The word bank is ambiguous because it stands for financial institutions, but also for pieces of furniture. And of course, if you have two different concepts, you have also two different classes. So the predicate does not only mean different concepts, it denotes different classes corresponding to the different concepts. That is ambiguity. Synonymy is exactly the opposite. Then you have one concept for which there are several predicates. So you have the word prison and the word jail, but they both stand for the same institution for punishment. So you have one single concept. And since the concept determines a class, you have also one single class. The class of prisons or the class of jails, but they are the same class. That is synonymy. So you can use these notions about concepts to explain phenomena like synonymy and ambiguity. Another interesting phenomenon in connection to concepts is, at least in the classical theory, that they are composed. We have already seen it in the hierarchy of concepts. Take the concept of a tiger. I will be very simplistic about tigers. Let's say that a tiger is defined as an animal of prey, which is feline, like a cat. Of course, there are more, the lions belong to the same, but let's assume that this is sufficient for tigers, to keep the example simple. So a tiger, as a concept, stands for an animal of prey, which is feline. Here we have the criterion for what a tiger is. If you want to know whether something is a tiger, you have to check whether it's an animal of prey and whether it's feline. And if both conditions are met, it is a tiger. If the conditions are not met, it's not a tiger. So if you have a plastic tiger, then it's not really a tiger because something of plastic is not an animal of prey. And therefore, it's not a real tiger, although it looks like a tiger. But the concepts which are used to define a tiger can also be decomposed. If you take an animal of prey, it must be an animal which eats other animals. Again, the definition is very simplistic, but for the sake of simplicity, I'll use this. So a tiger would be feline, and it would be, and now we go to animal of prey, it would be an animal which eats other animals. And you can apply the same decomposition to the notion of an animal. What is an animal? Well, that is a living being which can move autonomously. So we have a tiger is feline, it eats other animals, it is a living being, and it can move autonomously. All those conditions must be met for something to be a tiger. this composition can be used, a composition and decomposition can again be used to explain a number of phenomena. You can, for instance, say that a tiger is a feline living being that can move autonomously and which feeds on other animals. That is true. But what facts in the world must exist to make this true? Actually, none. Perhaps no such thing exists, and then you don't have anything in the world which fits this definition. This is purely true because of the definition of what a tiger is. And the definition still holds even if there are no real tigers. Take, for instance, unicorn. We know what a unicorn is. That is a kind of horse with a horn on its nose. There are no unicorns. But you know what the concept of a unicorn is, and you can say that a unicorn is a horse with a horn on its nose. That is true, but there are no facts in the world which make it true. It's purely the definition. Such sentences, which are true by definition, are called tautologies. Tautologies are sentences which are true purely by means of the meaning of the nature of the concepts which are involved in it. And it has to do with the composition. Tiger is an animal and therefore a living being, it's feline, etc. So you can use the decomposition of the concept of a tiger to explain the tautology. In the same manner, you can also explain contradictions. You can say Clarence is a tiger, which is not an animal. Well, that's nonsense. If it's a tiger, it must be an animal. So the statement cannot be true. Do we need to look at Clarence to see whether it's true? No, not at all. Even if you put another name there, say Henry. Henry is a tiger, which is not an animal, is false for exactly the same reason. Namely, a tiger is by definition an animal. A sentence which is false purely by definition of the words included in it, say the meanings, the concepts, is a contradiction. And if you have a good understanding of concepts, you know what kinds of things are contradiction, just like you know what things are tautologies. But there, of course, there are also sentences the truth of which depends on the facts in the world. If you say the cat is on the mat, there is nothing to be determined about its truth going by the concepts. Even if you know exactly what the concepts cat and mat are, you still don't know whether the statement is true. You have to look to the outside world. Such judgments are called contingent. They give information about the world and not about our concepts. Okay, these are some insights from the classical philosophical theory about what concepts are. But there are some reasons to assume that this theory is not, or at least not completely correct. And you can see that from a number of so-called problematic cases. One kind of problematic case is a borderline case. Suppose that a dog is defined as a four-legged animal that barks. Is a dog with only three legs, for instance, a dog that had an accident with a car, still a dog? Well, you might say, yes, it is a dog, but only a dog with a leg less. But then, if that's correct, the decomposition of the concept of a dog into animal with four legs is incorrect. If that's a good decomposition, it stopped, the animal stops being a dog if it has this accident. Another example, a car in a museum, is that still a car? Borderline cases, such as this example about a dog and about a car in a museum, show a problem for the classical theory of concepts, because the classical theory assumes that if a concept applies to a case, all the elements in the concept must also apply. And if one of those elements is not present, the concept cannot apply anymore. So you could not have dogs with less than four legs. It should stop being a dog. Nevertheless, we would like to call dogs with three legs still dogs. So that might be problematic for the classical theory. Another example is what's called philosophically called family resemblance. I'll explain that later. But if you have a classical theory of concepts, all the members of a class, which is defined by a concept, must have the same common characteristics. For instance, all cars have a set of characteristics in common. Sometimes that doesn't seem to work. A famous example in this connection is the concept of a game. There is no common characteristic which all games have. All games resemble another game, but they don't resemble all other games. For instance, the game of chess resembles the game of Go, which is not a Chinese or Japanese game. But it does not very much resemble speed skating. You can make small steps from speed skating to other sports. In the end, you may end up with chess or with Go. All members of this big class of games resemble some other elements of the same class, but they don't resemble all members of the class. Just like members of a family, that's why the name family resemblance comes from. Every member of a family, let's assume, somehow resembles one other member of the same family, but they don't all resemble each other. So, in practice, you have this phenomenon of family resemblances, members of a class which do not look or have the same characteristics as all other members of the class and still belong to the same class. That doesn't fit in the classical picture either. And then you have gradual concepts. Sometimes the applicability of a concept is not an all or nothing matter, although the classical theory would say so, that it would be. For instance, when is a person bald? You have baldness in degrees. I, for example, am quite bald, but not completely. That doesn't fit very well in the classical theory. And if concepts are composable or composed of other concepts, you have a problem with the most basic concepts, because then there are no other concepts to compose them into. For instance, when is something living? Animals, you might include in the definition of an animal that it lives. But if you do that, then you still have to define what living means. Perhaps you can find other concepts, but the chain of concepts of definition must end somewhere. And for those concepts completely at the bottom of the chain of definitions, there are no composing concepts anymore. So the theory about concepts cannot apply to those concepts, the most basic ones. But if it doesn't apply to those most basic concepts, is it correct theory then? Or value judgments? It is possible that two persons agree on all ordinary characteristics of a football match. Can they still then disagree about whether the match was a good one? If the notion of goodness, a concept, can be decomposed into other characteristics, and if the people agree about all those other characteristics, they should agree about whether the match is good. But is that really true? Isn't it possible to agree on all characteristics of a football match and one person saying, yes, but it was a bad match, while the other person says, no, it's a very good match. What are the characteristics of goodness? And then you have theoretical concepts. Some concepts are completely embedded in a theory and defined by the theory, and it's very difficult to pin them down to more down-to-earth concepts from which they are composed. For instance, what are the characteristics of ownership? It's very difficult to decompose this concept into other concepts. Okay, so we have a number of problematic cases. And you can say, well, every theory has its problematic cases. But here there are so many problematic cases that many people have thought from, okay, this classical philosophical theory cannot be correct. And they developed another theory, which is the theory of prototypes and deviations. to understand the difference, you must realize that in the classical theory, you have a word, and the word stands for a concept, and the concept determines what belongs to the class. So you have, for instance, the concept of a tiger, and this concept of a tiger determines what a tiger is. So you can look to the characteristics that compose the concept of tiger, and you check a particular animal, does it have all the characteristics for a tiger? If so, then it's a tiger. If not, then it's not a tiger. The concept determines the class. Well, this theory of prototypes and deviations, which is psychologically more attractive, works the other way around. The idea is that concepts are the result of clustering entities together in a class. So you have a class first. Somehow you throw things together, all kinds of animals. And say, okay, those animals are similar, and we call them tigers. And then you can develop a theory of what these entities have in common. So on the classical theory, classical view, you first have the theory in the form of criteria for what a tiger is, and then you can determine which animals fall into the class. On this theory of prototypes and deviations, you start with a number of animals which are similar, say that they belong to the same class, and then you try to figure out what the characteristics are that the entities in this class have in common. Take another example. We group a number of things together into the class of fruits, and then you can try to figure out, okay, what have all these fruits in common? Well, typically you will find difficult to find the common characteristics of all the entities in a class. You have more typical entities of a class. For instance, if you have, you call those prototypes. For instance, apples and pears are prototypical fruits. Tomatoes are less typical, but they are still fruits. And nuts are at best marginal instances of a fruit. So then you can even debate, does it belong to the class or does it not belong to the class? On the classical theory, this would be unproblematic because you have a concept. The concept gives you criteria for the class, and you just check the things by means of the criteria. But here we have already a class, and then we must develop the criteria out of the class. But then you must first decide what belongs to the class, and that's not so obvious. Yes, apples and pears are clear, tomatoes most likely also, nuts, well, you can have a debate about it. Such debates actually take place, for instance, debate about what is a planet or what is a fish. And then only after the debate is finished, you can formulate criteria. So concepts are developed as a theory of what defines a class, and not the other way around. Biologists develop theories about what is a fish, and then first they have to answer the question, are dolphins fish? Or are viruses living animals? I know a famous Flemish politician who said that viruses were very small animals. Completely wrong, but nevertheless, you can debate about it. Are exoplanets, such as Mercurius, real planets? Jurisprudence may develop a theory of what defines a property right. But then you first have to define what you want to consider as a property right. Are mortgages property rights? Is the right to privacy a property right? That's quite complicated. And only after you have taken these decisions, you can develop a theory of what constitutes the concept of a property right. But here we already have entered the territory of the second part of the lecture. This part stops now. You have an impression of what concepts are, and the next part of the lecture will be about some typical theoretical legal concepts. Thank you very much for your attention.